Hey there, in this short video, we're going to cover three main things. First of all, we're going to look at what COSHH is. Secondly, we're going to look at how you can identify hazardous substances and the potential impact of them. Thirdly, we're going to look at what employers must do to protect their people from harm. Okay, I get it. I know there's about as much chance as you staying to the end of this video as there is of me waking up with a full head of hair in the morning. Yes! So I've cheekily dropped in a quiz at the end of the video to test your knowledge to see if you picked up on all the important points covered. So make sure to stick around to see if you can get those correct.
You are the weakest link. Goodbye.
First of all, let's answer the simple question, what is COSHH? Well, COSHH relates to the UK regulations that are named Control of Substances Hazardous to Health. These regulations stipulate that employers must prevent or reduce workers' exposure to substances that may be harmful to their health. If you're not in the UK, don't panic. Most other countries with good health and safety regulation have some form of hazardous substance legislation in place, and it just may be called something slightly different. For example, in Australia they call it managing risk of hazardous chemicals. In the USA they refer to chemical hazards and toxic substances. And in Ireland, they talk about chemical agents and carcinogens. But roughly, it's all talking about the same type of thing. So let me ask you a simple question. When you think about hazardous substances or chemicals, what pops into your head? If you're like most people, it'll probably be an image of some old rusty drum of liquids lying in an old disused warehouse or yard, like something you would see in the movies. The truth is, we'll all have our own individual perception as to what chemicals or hazardous substances are due to our own experiences in and outside the workplace. The reality is that chemical and hazardous substances can come in a range of different physical forms. Let's look at some of them. First of all, liquids. We've already touched on liquids, and most people would think of liquids as their first go-to when it comes to thinking about chemicals and hazardous substances. There are many types of hazardous substances that are found in liquid form. For example, cleaning products, fuels, pesticides, processed chemicals, and even liquefied gases. The next common form that we come across are dusts. Dusts are tiny dry particles suspended in the air, and they can come from all sorts of different substances, including wood, concrete, bricks, glass, grains, and flour. Just a quick reminder. It's really important to remember that dusts can be created by a number of very common work activities, such as cutting, drilling, grinding, and sanding, to name a few. Next up, we have a group of chemical forms that people often get confused, and that's okay. But we're going to group them together here and tell you quickly what the difference is between each type to help you recognize them. What are these forms that I'm referring to? It's gases, vapors, mists, and fumes. Let's look at them briefly. First of all, we have gases. Gases are made up of molecules in constant random motion, and they are usually invisible to the naked eye. In the commercial settings, we often have to deal with the additional risk that these gases are highly pressurized. Of course, there's a whole range of different types of gases, and the level of harm potential from them is a huge spectrum in itself. So it's very important to know exactly what types of gases or gas mixes that you're dealing with in the commercial environment before you use them. Next up, we have vapors. A vapor isn't quite a gas, but it's a substance in its gas phase that usually exists as a solid or liquid under ambient conditions. For example, water vapor is water in its gas phase. This happens during the process of evaporation, and it can occur across a range of atmospheric conditions. Potentially harmful vapors that we come across very often in industrial settings include those that would be classed as solvent vapors. They are released from things like adhesives or glues, paints, and inks. The next one then are mists.
A mist is really a tiny water droplet that is suspended in the air. You'll see mists when you're, for example, using a powered jet, trigger sprays on cleaning products, for example, or even when using hand dispensers to release a liquid. And then we have fumes. Fumes are a mixture of gases and fine particles that are created from heating a solid. For example, fumes are created when you're welding an object using a metal or soldering, for example. Of course, in these circumstances, we'll want to have strong and strict control measures around the extraction of these potentially harmful or carcinogenic fumes when you're performing that type of work.
When you're considering the potential for harm, a multitude of factors needs to be taken into account. That includes things like the specific products themselves and their characteristics, the quantity and the form that they are in, the type of use, the potential pathways and duration of exposure, control measures that are in place, such as the system design or the process design, filtration, ventilation, and personal protective equipment or PPE. So, how do we figure out what is a COSHH material and what's not? Is there an easy way to do it? Let's find out. One of the easiest ways to find out and clarify if a material is indeed hazardous to health and or falls under COSHH is to check if there's a safety data sheet. So if you check with a manufacturer, they should have produced a safety data sheet if the material falls under one of the hazard classes of the globally harmonized system. So what that essentially means is if there's a safety data sheet, then there is potential harm from the material and it ain't so harmless after all. Let's dig a little deeper. As you can see on the screen at the moment, there are hazard classes that are denoted by pictograms. As you can see, the lovely pictograms, they relate to specific types of harm that can occur from material. So those are the things that we use as guidance in the safety data sheet, and then there's supplementary information to back that up. So let's look at where we can find that in our safety data sheets. Some of the information that we can get from the SDS should be things like the hazard classes, precautionary statements around the potential harm that can be caused, first aid measures and firefighting measures, for example, and personal protective equipment that should be worn when using the material. But we can go into more detail to look at SDSs specifically. If you'd like that, drop a comment and we'll make a video specifically for that and how to get the right information out of it.
Just a quick reminder.
But it's not just the SDS that holds that information. Some of the info should be summarized elsewhere. Can you think of where that might be? It's a pretty obvious one, actually, when you think about it. Most of the products should have information, including the hazard pictograms on the label itself and short version of instructions relating to first aid measures and the potential harm that can be caused. So look out for those. Make sure your chemicals are retained in their original packaging, and if they're taken out of it, put a label on it with the important information on it, just so things don't get confused. That's a tip that is very useful in the workplace environment.
One of the key aspects of managing hazardous substances, or COSHH, is understanding the level of risk that exists within your specific operation or activity. Performing a COSHH assessment is a fundamental part of that process. A COSHH assessment is a structured review of the hazardous properties of a substance or substances that you use within your workplace, looking at how they are used within your work practices, including any interactions between different hazardous substances themselves, and of course, identifying any necessary control measures that are needed to prevent harm to health. You can keep your COSHH assessments as standalone documents, but it's often very useful to link them into existing risk assessments and/or work process documentation that already exists within your business. It really just depends on what way your business normally operates. In summary, at the end of your COSHH assessment, it should be very clear as to which hazardous substances you use within your workplace, how they should be used within that environment, and of course, what control measures should be in place to make sure no one comes to harm. Okay, now that you've made it towards the end of this video, we promised that we'd do a quick quiz to check to see if you were paying attention and have picked up on some of the key points that were communicated throughout. So if you're ready, let's get going. Okay, welcome to our quiz here. It's going to take very little time to get through this. We've got three questions. Okay, the first question that we have is, which document must a manufacturer or producer provide for a hazardous substance? Is it A, Safety Analysis Sheet, or SAS? Is it B, Job Safety Assessment, JSA? Or C, Safety Data Sheet, SDS? The answer to question one was C, Safety Data Sheet, or SDS. Question number two then, which hazardous chemical form typically results from the heating of a solid? For example, in welding. Is it A, liquid, B, a mist, or C, a fume? The answer to question two was again C, fume. Question three, and our last one here then, is what must an employer in the UK, this is, carry out to ensure they comply with the COSHH regulations? Is it A, a standard operating procedure or SOP, B, a COSHH assessment, or C, a DSE assessment? And the answer for question three, of course, is B, a COSHH assessment. Well done for making it to the end and hopefully successfully completing our quiz, which if you were paying attention, should have been fairly easy. But if you didn't get them all right, don't be afraid to go back and watch the content again if you have time. Thank you so much for sticking with us, and hopefully this has been valuable for you. Make sure not to forget that we do have lots of resources, templates, and even free courses over at safety.com that you can make use of right now, and we'll drop some links below for you to access them. As always, if you've enjoyed the content, please give us a thumbs up and subscribe to the channel for any new content that comes out. If you do have any questions, please drop them in the comments below, and I look forward to getting back to you. Until next time, take care.